Well, I'm excited about what we're sharing this morning. The Holy Spirit will visit you in many different ways. And He visited me this morning in a very different way. I was thankful that He did. I was really thankful. It was such it was special. And I was thankful to what God would share with us. So what we'd like to talk about this morning is something that I think every single one of us can relate to. Because it is something that happens to every believer. I guarantee that at one point in time or another, as a believer, you're going to go through what we're talking about today. It just so happens that we're in the best time of the year to discuss this kind of thing and to talk about it and minister on it. Coming right off of a tremendous service and tremendous week in Resurrection Sunday and the Passion Week, you know, it just brings so much joy. And when we think about the resurrection, when we think about the victory that happened, think about it. Imagine us today as one of the disciples of Christ. Whether you imagine yourself as one of the 12, just don't imagine you're Judas, okay? But imagining yourself as one of the 12, or maybe even one of the 120 in the upper room. However you imagine yourself, imagine you are one of the disciples of the Lord going through this incredible experience of up and down emotions, encouragements and discouragements, expectations and disappointments, all the different things you go through as a disciple who walked with the Lord, and specifically those disciples who walked with the Lord and heard God, heard the Lord Jesus speak to them about what was coming, about the plan of the Father, and how the Savior of the world would come here to this earth to save the lost, to redeem those who are lost and born in sin. And that's all of us. It's all of mankind. And so they walked with the Lord and they heard the words. But if you've done any study, if you understand anything about that 3.5 years of the Lord, you understand this, that the disciples didn't understand everything that the Lord said. They didn't. And that's why there were times of expectation and disappointment. There were times of encouragement because of incredible victories. Can you imagine being one of those who showed up with Jesus at Lazarus' house? Can you imagine being one of them? When everybody's there weeping, crying, and some people are probably looking at Jesus like, wow, where were you? Because Lazarus is dead. And then for Jesus to call out into a different dimension and say, Lazarus, come forth. And for Lazarus to rise from the dead, to come out of the tomb in his grave clothes, and Jesus says, loose him and let him go, and he's alive. And can you imagine being those disciples who are walking towards Lazarus and going, wow, what are we going to say? You know, Lazarus is dead now. How are we going to encourage? What are we going to do now? You know, being discouraged because the expectation was, hey, God's in our life. It should all work out. God's with us. Everything should be good. Let me get the report from someone who said, oh, Lazarus is dead. I think the report came from the Lord Jesus himself. Let's go now. Let's go see Lazarus. Respond, sleep. And the disciples are, oh, okay, we'll go wake him up. No. He's dead. Can you imagine being the disciple after Jesus calls Lazarus out of the grave and he comes out? I don't know how you would feel, but for me, I'm one of his guys. You follow me so far? I'm sort of lost. Want me to attend to?
No.
Again, I have no idea how you would feel. But me, I'd be like, that's right. right. My Savior just raised someone from the dead. That's right, and I'm with Him. We are victorious. No one would feel this way? I promise you, you would feel that way. You know, I know, because you and I can get a lesser blessing, like a little extra money in the check, and we're like, oh, hallelujah, everything's good, right? Over a little bit of money, and we're freaking out in a good way. Oh, I'm so blessed. Jesus raises somebody from the dead. I promise you, you'll be fired up. You'll be victorious.
Amen.
You'll be, boldly proclaiming, that's right, that's my Lord. That's Him. You know Him. His name is Jesus. I feel like I'm talking to another group of people because I'm looking around going, anybody getting this at all? Are you sort of getting it? Okay. I still haven't let you in on what we're actually talking about heaven. Thing is, everyone who follows Christ comes through these types of experiences, goes through these kinds of struggles. I want to minister to you on the subject of doubt this morning. Oh, I thought he was going to preach about victory and blessings. I thought he was going to tell us all about how awesome it is and how we, with God, we're healthy, wealthy, and wise. I got something better than that. With God, you are eternally forgiven, washed in the blood, and you don't have to worry about death, hell, and the grave. You don't have to worry about these temporary issues. Way better than a little temporary healthy, wealthy, and wise. Now, the reason we talked about the resurrection is because in that season, just imagine it, the disciples witnessed their Savior and their Lord being hung on a cross. And after being hung on a cross, they're together and they hear this news that Jesus is no longer in the grave. See, okay, just imagine the disciple, the believer, who's just totally broken because the one they hoped in, the one they believed, they even witnessed Him do the supernatural. So I don't get it. How is it that He can raise Lazarus from the dead? How is it that He can open blind eyes and the lame walk and the deaf hear and all of this, and yet He's now dead? He's gone. Can you imagine such a discouragement from the disciples are going? See, we're talking about doubt because doubt can come from so many different places. And sometimes doubt can come from discouragement.
Right.
We can sort of look at our walk with God and how there are times when God, you just see the evidence of God all over in your life. And then there are times when you see these, man, God, where you at? I just don't feel it. Ever been there? I just don't feel it. How many will be honest and lift the hand on that one? And the rest of you didn't even hear what I said, right? Let me say it again. How many of you have ever been there where you're like, I know I need to serve God, I know, I just don't feel it? You guys know what I'm talking about. Discouragement can bring down. Before we get into our actual story, which would be in John chapter 20, so you can turn there. One of the best stories about doubt, I find, is with John the Baptist. How many of you remember that guy? The guy with the crazy hair who ate weird stuff. He had interesting clothes, and where he lived and what he was about turned out to be Jesus' cousin.
Come on.
John the Baptist, the one that goes to before and proclaims the Lamb of God. Amazing Lamb of God. Jesus said of John the Baptist, there was no one born of women from the Old Testament till now greater than John. Are you listening?
Amen.
John the Baptist, Jesus said, no one born of women. That means, obviously, Jesus is born a woman, but He's also the Son of God, so no one's greater than Him. But Jesus said, no one born of woman until now is greater than John. Who's in that list that John's greater than? Let's see. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, Joseph, Elijah, Elisha, Ezekiel, Joshua, Caleb, it goes on. Powerful men and women of God, Sarah and Ruth and Deborah, and just go down the list of all these mighty men and women of God, and Jesus says that John the Baptist is greater than all of them. And yet, John the Baptist answers the call, does the work of the Lord, knows he's the one to proclaim the coming Messiah, the Lamb of God. And at the end of his life, we find John the Baptist in a dungeon, in a place, in prison. And he sends a messenger to Jesus. And he says, ask Jesus, is he the one? Or are we supposed to look for another? Anybody remember that?
Yes.
One of the great stories of doubt. Because think about it. Here he is in a dungeon now. He's sitting there going, is this how this was supposed to end up? Is this the plan? I'm supposed to proclaim the Lamb of God and everything, and everything's going good. I'm baptizing, everything's good, and now I end up in a dungeon. I better make sure I'm in the right place. I better make sure I'm serving the right God. Wow, what an experience of doubt. You know what I love about Jesus' response to John? He didn't send a messenger to go tell him, what's the matter with you? He didn't do that. He didn't send a messenger to go beat him up. You've been serving me all this time and you're doubting now? That was not the response. Aren't you glad that we have a loving, merciful Savior who knows when we struggle, who knows when we go through difficult times? Even though we know it's true, we go through difficult times, and the Lord doesn't send a message to John and beat him up and say, how dare you? You're my cousin. Don't you know? You were filled with the Holy Spirit when you were still in your mother's womb. What's the matter with you? He didn't do that. He sent the message. Go tell John what you've seen and heard. Go remind John of who he has believed in. So here we are in the season of the resurrection, and we're celebrating that Jesus rose from the dead. But I can promise you, in every believer, it happens where you can be on the mountaintop one day and in the valley low the next. There will be times when you are on the top of the mountain because everything's going right, and then the very next week, things happen, life happens, and you're there, you're struggling, and you might even go through a situation where you just feel like, I don't even know if I can continue. Well, the first thing I want to tell you is this before we get into this incredible story, is that Jesus is not sending me as a messenger today to say to you, what's the matter with you? You go to PC Montebello. You should be better than this. That's not the message. God's not beating you up. God's not saying to you, how dare you have doubt? How dare you slip and fall? How dare you be a knucklehead? Oh, I'm sorry, that was me. Ain't no knuckleheads in here, right? No? Hope not. I see some of you like, this one, there's an ugly one right there. No, that's not the message. Because God knows when we go through such things. He sends the message. Remember who I am. And I do allow life to happen. Because your hope is not in this earth. And it's not the temporary things that happen in this earth, the things you look for that temporary victory, that temporary joy. It's not there. Your victory is and always will be in the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. Whether it's on this earth or in the life to come, folks, it's all about Him. And He proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that He's with you. He's with you, and He will never leave you, and He will not forsake you. And I promise you that includes the times when you are in doubt.
Yes.
When you are questioning, when you're looking around going, why is life happening like this? Why is the devil allowed to live in my living room? Oh, I'm sorry. Maybe you didn't say that. I say, why is he allowed to live in my backyard? Does anybody know anything about my backyard? It looks demonic right now. It does. I'm just being honest. It looks demonic. God help us. I tell you, when he promised that, yeah, life happens. Yes, he allows things because this is where we live right now. Okay. Now would be a good time to maybe turn off our cell phones. Thank you. Thanks. I know your call's important. Maybe that was an alarm clock. All right. So, you might be right there right now. Imagine the disciples. So with this, John chapter 20, we're going to pick up the story in verse 19. This is the story. John chapter 20, verse 1 says, now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early. Those of you who've been in church a while, you know that that was the day that after the third day, he was no longer in the tomb. Mary was the first one there. You just kind of remember this, right? Excuse me. So John chapter 20, I'll give you some time. We're not going to read all that took place because we're going to pick it up from verse 19. I'll just say this, that there came a point the same day that all the disciples were in this house and all the doors were locked because they were afraid of the Jews. Of course they're afraid. They witnessed these horrible people. These demonic people putting Jesus on the cross, their very leader, their savior. So they're afraid for their lives. And they're in this room, they're in this house, and the doors are locked. Are you following so far? Okay. We know that Mary already seen Jesus. We know that, but let's pick it up from verse 19. Check this out. Then the same day at evening, okay, so we're in the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, peace be with you. Now, before I move past that, you just need to notice that there's a reason why it says the doors are shut and locked. It's not just to emphasize that they were afraid of the Jews, to keep the Jews out from coming and attacking them and collecting them up and hanging them on a cross. That detail is there for you and I to know that Almighty God, the Lord Jesus Christ, is able to do all things. So you notice it doesn't say, and somebody went and unlocked the door and invited Jesus in. It doesn't say that. You know what it says? It says, the door's locked, they're afraid, they're hiding out, and Jesus stands among them. Now I promise you, they didn't have any technology back then, so it wasn't like a hologram. It wasn't like Star Wars, you know? None of that. Jesus either walked through the wall, just appeared. I can't explain to you what happened. I can just tell you this. Doors locked, everything shut up, nobody's getting in, and Jesus is there. Amen. He's the Son of God, folks. When the Bible says he rose from the dead, he rose from the dead. He's alive forevermore. But not only is he all man who rose from the dead, he's Son of God who can do all things. He's all powerful. Powerful enough to walk through a wall. Or just beam into it. I don't know how it happened. Do you guys know? Let me know after service. Thank you. He shows up. He says, peace be with you. Verse 20. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. So Jesus said to them again, peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. So just understand, you know they're afraid, they're discouraged, they're wondering what to do now. Jesus shows up, empowers them with the Holy Spirit, gives them peace, lets them see the hands, the spike holes in his side, reassures them. You know what he didn't do? He didn't come. come in and say, look, that's the only problem you're ever going to go through is watching me die on the cross. The rest of the way is cake. The rest of the way is smooth sailing. He didn't say that, did he? Matter of fact, he didn't say anything about it. He just said, look at my hands, my side. It's been said, and I believe this with all my heart, there's only one man-made thing in heaven. Only one man-made thing, and that is the scars and the hands and feet of Jesus. If there's ever anything man-made in heaven, it would have to be the sign of death, wouldn't it? Because we're so imperfect. Are you still paying attention, guys? Yes. Are you still listening? Don't we kind of want to know what's the answer to this? All right, some of you are looking at me, come on, get on with it. All right. He blesses them. He doesn't tell them, you're not going to go through anything. And even further than that, he empowers them with the Holy Spirit, and then he sends them out. He says to them, well, I'm going to send you. As my Father sent me, now I'm sending you. So, hey, guess what, disciples? Not only did I just die, and he had to witness the death on the cross, and the worry and the discouragement, even the doubt of wondering if this is all over, and we failed, and maybe we were in the wrong thing the whole time. Not only did you have to go through that, and now that you see me that I'm alive, guess what? You got to go out there and keep the work going. And when you go out there, you might face a few things yourself. Remember what Jesus said. If the world hated him, so the world's going to hate us too. If you're all buddy-buddy with people who don't believe in the Lord, you might need to question whether you're really sharing God or not. People who don't know the Lord, if they're all buddy-buddy with you, hey, yeah, let's go get a drink, man. Oh, that was a good place for a hello. I don't hear that too much anymore. But it's true. Oh, wait a minute, Pastor. God told us to go share the word with the unbeliever. We got to hang out with them sometime. Of course you do. But if you're hanging out with them and they don't even know you're a believer, something's wrong. Party time. Something's wrong. Right or wrong? Am I right about this? Amen. The whole reason we hang out with them is to love on them, show them the love of Christ, model a life that is changed in front of them. When the door opens up to share the gospel, you do it. And in a situation where you may not get another chance, you just open the door. Yeah. All right. Why do I feel like this is unpopular this morning? I'm looking around. Smiles. I, to be honest with you, I have my glasses on, so the truth is I can't really see what you look like today. So I just see blurry people everywhere. But I can feel in this place that God, that God is speaking to our hearts. So let's keep going. Verse 21 says, I send you. Verse 22, and when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Holy Spirit. Verse 23, I have to read this and touch it because it's just one of the most confusing verses in the Bible. So you need to know. Verse 23, Jesus tells his disciples, if you forgive the sins of any, then they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. That's one of the most confusing scriptures in the Bible. Whole religions have taken this out of its context. Okay? Here's the reality. Here is the proper translation. This is not Jesus saying, okay, the disciples, apostles, you know, my servants, you have the power now to forgive sins. And if you forgive them, then it's as good as me forgiving them. That's incorrect. That is not what's being said. And we know of this because there are some religions who maintain the idea that their leadership, that their, whatever you would call them, pastors, priests, whatever, they maintain this idea that they're able to forgive sins and that you got to go through them to get to God. For there is only one mediator between man and God, and that is the man Christ Jesus. He's the only one. And by the way, Mary isn't either. As much as we love that awesome woman of God, no one was more blessed than Mary. Not just no women, no one else, no guy either. privilege and responsibility of raising little Jesus? Think about that. Raising little Jesus. All kinds of stories that are made up about what little Jesus did when he was a kid that aren't even in the Bible. Anyway, let's move on. So, what does it mean? It simply means this. As you go representing and you represent my message, if they receive, then you can proclaim to them in confidence. If you receive Christ, then I can tell you, if it's true, you're saved. You're forgiven. Not because I forgive you. I proclaim to you that he has forgiven you because you believed in him. You can proclaim that with confidence. That is that correct definition and translation. Because if that is not the case, then it does not go with any of the other scriptures in the Bible. It's actually contradicting. So think about it. We share, we plant, we water with the Word of God, but God's the one that saves.
Right.
And when he saves, have you ever told somebody, man, you know, I love your relationship with God, or, yeah, I can tell you're a Christian. Have you ever, nobody's ever said that? Has anybody said that about you? I hope so. All right, we're going to close in prayer because you guys all are looking tired on me now. Just keep going. Let's finish this. Main part of the story that we really want to touch on today. Verse 24. Now Thomas called the twin. If you have a new king, if you have an original King James, it should say Didymus. Thomas Didymus, right? And simply Didymus means like duplicated or twin. He was a twin. Thomas had a twin. So which one was there? No, I'm just kidding. Let's keep going. I'm just kidding. Verse 24. Now Thomas called the twin. One of the 12 was not with them when Jesus came. That's important to know, folks. When you look at the whole story of Thomas, he was one of the 12. He walked with Jesus for the 3.5 years. He got to see the miracles, witness the power, experience the love, and embrace and enjoy the forgiveness of God. Thomas was one of the 12. But the Bible reveals to us that when Jesus comes to meet with the disciples and he shows up, Thomas isn't there. He's not with them. Now, if you just read that, you might think, okay, that's interesting. But, you know, why is that important? Well, when you look at the whole picture and the whole story of Thomas, you realize he's that guy that everybody calls Doubting Thomas. Right? How many of you remember this? Amen. Doubting Thomas. Why did he get that nickname? Well, when we read further, we find out why he got the nickname. But I just want to point out to you that this is key to know, because the fact that he wasn't there might reveal to us what was already in the heart that hadn't been revealed yet. Why wasn't he with the body? Why wasn't he with his brothers and sisters? Whether they were afraid or not, why was he not there? Could it be because his doubts were getting the best of him? Could it be that his doubts were leading him slowly but surely out the door? Little by little, and just can't seem to have this, I don't know, I'm just not feeling it. That little by little, the lies of the world and the enemy and his own feelings, you know, slowly but surely he's out the door. Again, it reveals something, because instead of being with the family of God during a very difficult time, which would demonstrate faith and trust, it was more like, you know what? Now, we don't know what he was doing, but he wasn't with the body. Let me tell you something, folks. If you're in a time of discouragement, confusion, a time of weakness, I promise you the enemy will step in to try to pull you out of the body. When I say the body, I'm not just saying PCF, Montebello. We're not a cult. We are not a cult. I don't believe that, if you're not in this church, that you're not saved. You know that there's some churches that talk like that? Well, if you leave this church, our church, you're not saved. What? What Bible are they reading? Maybe you've experienced that. Maybe you were part of another church and they told you that if you go anywhere else, you're not saved. For those of you who've never had that, you ain't gonna ever have that happen here. Because the body of Christ is the body of Christ worldwide. Every believer who puts their trust in Jesus, that's your mother, that's your sister. And you might say, wait a minute, that's my brother, that giant turkey who looks crazy and I don't even know if he's... Notice that in the body of Christ, you gotta open up your heart and embrace, even if they don't meet your standard. Even if they don't fit in your imagination of what a believer looks like. Remember, we're all a work in progress. Right? We're a work in progress, and I'm thankful for that. That we're a work in progress. I'm thankful that God's not done with me yet. Say, God, you missed a spot. Well, I'm done. Thank God he's not done with us. You would have seen me and Brenda when we first came to the Lord. You would never, you'd be like, oh no. 30-some years ago, I was a giant turkey, that's all I'll say. I look like, oh, what do you want to say about that? Brenda was more shocking than that. I'll just say that. With her blue and pink and black mohawk, with no hair on one side, flapped over, looking all crazy, and all you're like, what? Sister Brenda did that? She was that, you know? Aren't you glad God is not done with us yet? There's a transformation that takes place. He's working on us. If there's no changes, you gotta ask him, are you even walking with him? It's funny because as I'm saying this, I'm looking at her kids and they're going, what? Mom was doing that? Yeah, and Josiah went, I'm kidding, Josiah. His eyes got big. What? My mom had a mohawk? She wasn't your mother yet. That's all I got to say. Some of you are like, she did? I didn't know that. We're a work in progress, folks. And God is not done with us. And so when you're part of the body of Christ, you're part of a big body. And it's not just this place. But it's important to know that God places us in local churches to edify the body. Because we can't be responsible for the whole world, the whole body. And we know that. It's impossible. You need to be in a local assembly where you get together, you serve each other, you edify and help each other, and serve the Lord. Thomas wasn't there when Jesus showed up. I'm almost done. Don't worry. I promise the food won't be cold at the break, at the lunch. Again, verse 24, Thomas called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. Verse 25, the other disciples therefore said to him, we have seen the Lord. So the disciples are telling Thomas, we've seen the Lord. So he said to them, unless I see his hands, the prints of the nails, or I put my finger in the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Now let's just hope our doubts, our struggles, our difficulties when life and struggles happen and the attacks, let's just hope we don't get to that point where we just finally decide, I'm just done. I'm not going to believe anymore. Because there's a difference between doubting, you believe, but you're weak and you're fighting through, and I just quit. What did Thomas, how did he get there? How? He was one of them who saw Lazarus come out of the grave. He witnessed all the things that people today think, if I saw that, my faith would grow. If there were more miracles, and I saw them, just in our church, if we saw more miracles in our church, man, it would blow up and everybody would believe stronger. Not necessarily. Here's Thomas. He's seen Lazarus rise from the dead. He saw blind Bartimaeus and the other guy, who the Bible doesn't name, get their eyes opened up. He saw the guy with his bed laying there who couldn't walk. Jesus raised him up and he can walk, folks. He's seen everything that we think we need to see to be stronger in our faith. Yet, here he is. He's out. I'm done. Shows up. Check on things. Hey, we saw the Lord. Look, I'm done. I'm not going to believe it unless I see it. Because I've seen too much. I can't take it anymore. How many of you have ever been there? Don't lift your hand on that one. Just think about it. You got to the place where, yeah, I know he's good. Yes, I know he's blessing us. Yes, I know he's with us. But what about this when that happened? What about that painful thing? What about that ugly thing that happened? You know what? I'm just done. I've seen too much. It's hard to give my whole heart when I've seen too much. That's what Doubting Thomas looked like right then and there. You want to finish this or you're done? Finish? All right, you asked for it. Bible says Jesus jumped in right there and said, what's the matter with you, Doubting Thomas? Is that what he said?
No.
That's right. That's not what he said. Let's read it. Verse 28. And after, catch this, 8 days. What? Little detail there that we read over every time. After 8 days. Jesus didn't just show up. Mr. Thomas, what was he doing for those 8 days? Was his doubts getting worse and worse? He's out the door. I don't know. None of us knows. All I know is Jesus waited for 8 days. You and I were like, come on, Lord, I need you to show up now. This is too hard for me now. I need you to help me now. And the Lord says, no, I'm going to show up in 8 days. 8 days, that's right. You're going to wait. You're too used to your microwave. 2 minutes, it's hot and ready to go. You're too used to Little Caesars, hot and ready. God says, no, you're going to wait. Because you're going to learn how to trust me even when you don't feel it. You're going to learn that truth is truth regardless of what you feel. We're going to feel bad. We're going to go up and down. We're going to have bad days. Life's going to happen. Satan's going to attack. Demonic forces. And the Lord will allow some things. But guess what? We don't serve God by feelings. We serve God by the truth, by what we know, by faith. We trust God. We trust Him. That's why we live in Him. That's why we keep going when we don't want to. So a little detail there. After 8 days, his disciples were again inside. Tells you what they were doing too, huh? Doubting Thomas was doubting, and Jesus already showed himself to the disciples. They were all excited, filled with the Holy Spirit. What are they doing back in the room? I'll tell you what they're doing. They're not filled with the Holy Spirit. They're all powered up. They're like, yeah, let's go. They go outside, oh no, life is happening again. Let's go back. Problems are happening again. I thought Jesus was going to be all good. No, you're going to face some stuff. Get out there. Live for me. So hey, they're back in the room. I don't have all the details here, but that's what's happening. After 8 days, his disciples were again inside. Thomas was now with them. That's interesting to me. Very interesting. And Jesus came, the doors being shut. There's that detail again. Guess what happened? Jesus just walked through the wall, or however he got there. I don't know. Tell me you know, because you don't either, because it's not in the Bible. All it tells us is the doors were shut, and Jesus showed up. Right? Jesus came, doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace to you. Then he said to Thomas, here's some of the best news ever. I get the feeling Jesus showed up just for Thomas. I get the feeling that there are times when Jesus shows up just for you. You're not just part of a crowd, people. Yes, we're part of the body of Christ, but you're also an individual, and He loves you. one-on-one. His love doesn't go through another person, although we need to love each other. His love is directly to you. Think about that. And so, he said to Thomas, reach your finger here. Look at my hands. Reach your hands here. Put it into my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. Thomas answered and said to him, my Lord, my God. And that's usually us. We need to see something first. Oh, my Lord, my God, thank you for that extra check in the mail. Perfect timing. Thank you, God, that, the doctor gave me some good news. Thank you. Sometimes our faith seems to rise because we see something or experience something that makes us feel better. Amen. Jesus said to him, verse 29, Thomas, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. He didn't beat up Thomas. He didn't rebuke him, but he taught him. I love that amen. That was an amen. Out of the mouth of babes, right? Yeah! Pretty soon it'll sound like amen, but right now, that's it. Either that or she's a singer. Wanted to praise the Lord. He didn't beat up Thomas. He didn't rebuke him. He taught him. So Thomas, you believe because you see. But blessed are those who believe even when they don't see. Isn't that what a walk of faith is? Amen. Isn't that what a walk of faith is really about? There's going to be times when you don't see the hand of God move. But guess what? There's going to be times you will. Those times should not be different. We love him because he first loved us. We trust him even when things aren't going well. We continue on because he is worthy even when we don't